are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And oh, these are days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sore. Still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Oh, he comes riding on the cloud, shining like the sun. Have the trumpet call, lift your voice. The year of Jubilee, now that Zion's hill salvation come. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. These are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of faith. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in the world. And we are your laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes riding on the cloud, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. Year of Jubilee, out of Zion's hill, salvation.
Amen. Good morning, Life Church. And we're going to do things a little bit different this week. I've often said that I think I need one of those t-shirts that says something along the lines of cleverly disguised as responsible adult. Do we have any of those people in the house this morning that would wear that shirt with me? Yes, man. Yes. And so I get asked sometimes, and this is just evidence to it, like, man, how has the church grown so fast? Like, it has to be God. Because I'm just not that organized. It's just deductive reasoning. Even for the skeptics of life. Yeah, my wife's amening that too enthusiastically. Isn't she, Billy?
That's awesome.
But I got a couple questions this week, and I thought, you know what? It is probably time that we just have a little three-minute fireside chat. So if you're new here, welcome. We're glad you're here. We love our visitors. We hope that our visitors become lifers, which is what we call our church members. But if you're a first-time guest, you might notice, like, we don't take up an offering. It's not that we're anti-offering or that we hate your money. But I don't want people coming into the house of God thinking that they're trying to be sold a timeshare. Amen, if you understand. So we believe that the Bible teaches that everybody should give as God has led them. Every man, the Bible says, as God purposes in his heart. So if you want to give financially this morning, we want to give you that opportunity. There's a box right here in the back. If you look all the way back in the back, right under the exit sign, there's a box there, and there's also a box marked offering as you come in the door. There are black buckets at both exits. So if you want to give something, then that's how you're encouraged to give and how you want to give. Secondly, I got asked this week about life groups. We don't have a Sunday school format. We do what are called life groups. We have some that meet on Sunday morning, every Sunday morning. We have some that are meeting through the week, and we don't have as many right now meeting as we did before the entire world shut down due to COVID. But I would encourage you to get in a life group. I would encourage you that if you're interested in starting one, please get with me. Call me. Get with me. I would love to talk to you about that. We're going to try to do a push for a life group. We believe in discipleship. Disciples make disciples, and we want people being discipled. And so we ask that you get into a life group. Also, third, kids' life. We are a growing church, and we love kids, and we love families with kids, and we hope we get more and more families and more kids. But because of that, we need help upstairs. Did everybody hear me say it? Does everybody know what a pet peeve is? One of my biggest pet peeves as your pastor is when people go like, well, I didn't know. Like, so now, say amen if you hear me say, we need help upstairs with the kids.
Amen.
Okay, if that's not your cup of tea, don't sign up. But if you are the person that says, hey, I can do that. I can help. I can be an assistant. I can watch and make sure that Timmy doesn't escape. Or that little Billy's not putting Cheerios in Alicia's ear. Right? If you can do that, we need your help. See Travis Coomer, see Courtney. Last but certainly not least, we have a church that is always active and always looking to further the kingdom of God and meet needs. This week we got to clothe a lot of people right here in our county. It actually blew me away as to how many people couldn't get home because little creeks had gotten out of their banks and washed out bridges and all those types of things. And we were able to put people up and give them a place to stay. We were able to take them groceries. One day I think I was at Kroger and the lady was like, weren't you just here? And I was like, yes. Love those fuel points. But we got to take food to produce, and we got to clothe so many people. And right now, that's what we like to do. We like to do things in our county, but we also recognize that worldwide missions are important too. In other words, the souls in Pulaski County are just as important as the souls in China and vice versa. But right now, you have a team, from a four-man team from your church right now that's on their way to the Navajo Reservation to lay water pipe, to build playgrounds, to make sure that some homes get electricity, and to deliver an 18-foot trailer full of supplies. Isn't that awesome? Amen. So over the coming days, we're going to be clothing and feeding some more people, and I love to do that. So I want to do a couple things this morning. Let's just pray, and let's pray for them and ask God's blessing upon them, ask that God watch over and provide and take care of them, that he would go before them, that he would open up doors. But then let's also pray that God would bless our service here today. Amen. Don't you just love when you get to feel the Holy Spirit? Me too, and it's kind of an addictive feeling, and I want to feel it again today. So let's pray, okay? Father God, I thank you so much for this, your church. Lord, I'm thankful for the way that you've blessed it, the way that you've added to it. Lord, the way that you've continually provided for it. And so, Lord, we just again give it to you, Lord, every ministry, every program. Lord, we ask that you would help us as your disciples make more disciples. Lord, I lift the team up to you. Lord, I pray that you would watch over them, give them safety as they travel. But Lord, we also ask that you would go before them, that you would open up doors, that you would fill them with your spirit, that you would give them words to share. And Lord, I pray that the people that they reach, Lord, would see your love through them. Now, Lord, we ask that you would bless this service, Lord, that your presence would fall, and Lord, that we would do business with you. Lord, as your word is proclaimed in song and in sermon, Lord, we ask that it would be you that is seen and heard. Bless this, your church. Bless the time we get to spend together. Lord, bless this time of worship. In Jesus' name, amen.
Nothing else will do, and I just want you. Oh, nothing else. shadow you wanna light up. Mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, a lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, a lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow.
Serve our great God this morning, amen. He's our way maker, amen. Sing this out from the bottom of our hearts this morning.
I worship you. I worship.
Morning. Who else is glad they came to church today? If you have your Bibles, take them, open them up to Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. We're going to continue our series this morning, What in the World is Going On? So in other words, we're looking at our world, our culture, our society. We're examining it and we're laying the Bible on the other side. And you've heard me say this, I think, a couple times in and throughout this series, but the answer to the question and the title is exactly what the Bible said would be going on. Amen? So while life has a way of sneaking up on us and throwing us proverbial curveballs, like we have sayings, when it rains, it pours, and I didn't see that coming. God doesn't say stuff like that. And this is one of the things that I don't know about you, but it's such a comforting to me, because when God speaks, I don't know if you've ever noticed this, but it's in the declarative, like it's emphatic. It's like, I, the Lord, have spoken it. And if you were here back in, I think, the summer or last year when we did our sermon series on The Voice, when God says something, it's going to happen. And so as we continue through this series, we've looked at what our culture is going to look like. We looked at some different signs that the Bible talks about that would be signs of the quote-unquote last days. Then we've even looked at a sermon that was entirely revolving around the church. What is the religious establishment of the day going to look like in the last days? And so today we turn our attention back to the narrative of Matthew chapter 24, and we examine the words of our Lord. If you're there, say amen. Stand with me as we honor the reading of the Word of God. We're going to read verse number 36 down to verse number 42. The Bible says, but of that day and hour, who knows? No one. Not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. Now we get a transition, and this is what we're going to focus on today. So watch this. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark, and did not know until the flood came and took them all away, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field. One will be taken and the other what? Left. Two women will be grinding at the mill. One will be taken and the other left. Now notice the words of our Lord and how he concludes this. He says, watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming. Do you see it? Say amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we sure are thankful for your word. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to be doers of it this morning. Pray that you would use it to speak to hearts. Lord, we thank you for your presence that we feel in this place. And Lord, now I pray that you would speak and do what only you can do. Lord, I ask that you would comfort. Lord, I pray that you would convict. Lord, I ask that if there's one here today that has never been saved, that today would be the day, Lord, that they give their heart and their life to you. Lord, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. Lord, we just ask that you would bless the time that we get to spend together. Lord, I ask that it would be your voice that's heard today, not mine. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Point number one, first stop on the bus. Touch your neighbor and tell them it's the end of the world as we know it. But I think it's fascinating what Jesus likens his return to. Of all the days and of all times and of all the Bible stories, he's going through this narrative, some of which we've already looked at, and he says, hey, you're going to see wars, there's going to be rumors of wars, there's going to be earthquakes, there's going to be pestilence, you're going to see disease and sickness, and you're going to see a lot of deception. And then he changes gears and he starts talking in the passage that we just read. He says, and oh, by the way, just as it was in the days of Noah, so I liken my return as unto. And I find that fascinating. And so there's a lot to do here. So I want to be a little bit teachy and a little bit preachy this morning. Is that okay? But he says, first, the description of the day. So Jesus' description, let's go back and look at it. Look in your Bible. I want you to see it with me. He says they were eating, they were drinking, and they were marrying. Now, if you know anything about the Scriptures, being married is a blessing. Billy Biddle got it. There's one guy in this building that earned brownie points this morning. It was Billy. Everybody say, good job, Billy. Tossing softballs and y'all whiffing. Fumbled on the 1 yard line. Snatched defeat from the jaws of victory. I could do this all day. But God gave marriage as a blessing. So the question becomes, from a doctrinal, theological standpoint, is being married wrong? No. Well, a person has to consume water. They have to drink. This is the way that God designed the body, so it can't be an accountability thing. Here's what I think that Jesus is trying to describe, is that it is going to be just like it was in the days of Noah, in that it's the end of the world as we know it, but everybody feels fine. So let's look at the Genesis description to what this time looked like. Look at it with me. Genesis 6:6. So if we go from Matthew 24 all the way back to Noah's account, like which I think is reasonable and logical, if Jesus said it's going to be like it was in the days of Noah, let's go back and see what it was like in the days of Noah. Genesis 6:6. Then the Lord saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was on evil continually. Literally what the Bible is saying here, that in the days of Noah, the earth was incredibly wicked. And as a matter of fact, I challenge you to hone in on the last part. It was evil, and evil intentions and evil thoughts perpetually and continually. And now I think that, again, we go back to Matthew 24. Who knows when Jesus is going to come back? Nobody. But at the same time, we're looking at signs in and throughout this series. And if we are living in the last days, then what would this look like? Well, it would look like a time when you looked at your world and it seemed to be getting progressively and progressively more evil until everything was evil. It might look like people doing evil acts. It might look like, I don't know, things that you know are bad they're calling good and the good they're calling bad. It could look like that. It could look like there would be good things going on, but they're calling those evil. It could be that they start to see evil everywhere. It could even get so bad, and I don't want to seem prophetic here, but it could get so bad that you might see stuff that you know is evil be called good, but things that are completely moot or fine or innocent are called evil. Like, for instance, in a week's time, Mr. Potato Head could become evil. Dr. Seuss could become evil. But burning down an entire city block could become good. I'm not saying that's what it is. I'm just saying that's what it could look like. The good is bad and the bad is good. And this is what Jesus says about the days of Noah, is that it got progressively and progressively more wicked. Look at the same narrative, chapter 6, let's stay there, 11 and 12. The earth also was corrupt before God. The earth was filled with violence. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt. For all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. Now let's go back to Jesus' description. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark and did not know until the flood came and took them all away, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Yeah, we got that, Pastor. And this is the part where we maybe transition from teaching a little bit to preaching a little bit, is that it's the end of the world, but I feel fine, and so does the rest of the world. That's the mentality of the day. Is that, I don't know about you, but have anywhere in the last couple of years, have you just kind of had this thought, maybe not exactly, but you kind of had this feeling and this sneaking suspicion that you feel like a stranger in a strange land? I mean, how many moments throughout this year have you been just like dealing with something, watching something, listening to something, and going, did everybody just wake up and take stupid pills? What is going on? Like, that doesn't even make any good, logical, walking around sense. I mean, how many times have you looked at your television screen and go, what are we doing? And we're just told, it's got to, remember a couple weeks ago? It's a pineapple. But now we've all got to pretend that it's not really a pineapple, it's a hippopotamus. And this is what Jesus likened this day to. He said it's going to be a day and age where they think about wicked things, that they can make anything wicked, and that they will continue to do evil and evil and evil and evil and more evil. And this is the reason that I don't want to be like Debbie Downer here, but at the same time, I've got to preach this. It's comforting to me to know that exactly some of the stuff that I see happening in my world, in my culture, in my society, is stuff that the Lord said would happen in His Word. So a lot of this stuff doesn't hold the shock factor for me. I can disagree with it, but I can't say that I'm shocked by it. Is there anybody else in church today that says, like, I've lost my shock factor? Nothing surprises me anymore. And so then we transition into this. So just like the song, it's the end of the world as we know it, but I feel fine. And then we transition into sign, sign, everywhere, a sign. Let's go back and see what Jesus said in Matthew 24, verse 3. Now, as He sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to Him privately saying, tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of Your coming? Now, a little doctrinal teaching here. I don't think they're talking about His first coming because He's there talking to them. Does that make sense? Okay. And, if we needed more context, here it is, and of the end of the age. It's now kind of evident what we're talking about. Now, the sign of preaching, I think, is the first one we have to go with. So if you go to 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, the Bible calls Noah a preacher of righteousness. That's what it calls him. And I'll tell you one of the things, this is a side note, completely off the rails, but sometime today, go on the internet, spend some time, and just Google evidence for a global flood. It's fascinating. There is an account of a global flood on every single, like every place in human history. And look at the scientific evidence for a global flood. It's free, you're welcome, won't cost you anything extra. But maybe the reason that they don't want the flood to have existed is because then if the flood didn't exist, then the judgment of God didn't exist. And then Matthew chapter 24, do you get it? And so if we can chalk all this up to fairy tale, then there's no accountability. There's no responsibility. And if you know anything about our culture and our society today, it's that it's somebody else's fault. I'm not responsible for anything. I'm a victim. I was telling Matt before, if you can't beat them, join them. So I've solved my money troubles and all your money troubles. I have self-identified as the starting point guard for the Indiana Pacers. And I have a $150 million shoe contract. That has nothing to do with my salary. So you're welcome, church. We're getting ready to be doing big things. Everybody having fun? And I think what is fascinating here, because God gives Noah this task. He says, I want you to build an ark. But the entire time that Noah was building the ark, apparently he was preaching a message. Now, we don't get one of Noah's sermon outlines, but I think it was probably a pretty simple conceptual sermon. It probably went something like, you all are wicked. God says He's going to judge this wickedness. That's why I'm building this boat. because there's a flood coming. Would you agree with that? Pretty simple and concise message. But here's what we also know, is that the people ignored the message. And the reason that I know that, because besides Noah and his family, nobody else got on the ark. The animals actually had more sense than the people of the day did. Just like it was in the days of Noah. So also, they get it. But I thought about Noah's message as a preacher is a sign. He's giving them the sign. For 120 years straight, he preached a message that went, get on the boat. Get on the ark. God is sending judgment. And the only way to escape it is this ark. Have you ever thought of this? The ark itself is a sign. It's a sign of God's providence. It's a sign of God's provision. It's a sign of God's mercy. It's a sign of God's grace. But it's also a flashing neon sign that says, this Noah guy that you all have chalked up to a nut job and a religious fanatic actually believes what he's saying, because he's dumping his entire retirement, 401k, and life savings into building this massive boat. We have an ark in Kentucky. Do you know that tons of people go see that ark? Don't you think that they went and saw Noah's too? Man, that's free entertainment. Come on, kids, let's go see how much more Noah's got done on his boat. And while they're there, he preaches them a message. Here's the sign. Here's the message. But there's also here, and I want you to understand this, and this is where we go. Where you're looking at a literal place of grace. That's what the ark was. So if we were to simplify the account of Noah, let me preach it very quickly and very simplistically. Sin was high. Righteousness was low. God's going to send a global flood to destroy all of humanity. Judgment was coming. Amen? So God tells Noah, I want you to build the ark. But nestled in all this wickedness and evil, in Genesis chapter 6, is one of the most beautiful verses. And here's the part where I get to enjoy my job, because I get to preach glad tidings and great joy. Is I don't know about you, but this world is getting darker, but joy comes in the morning. And I don't know about you, but life has a way of making ash, but God says I can make beauty from it. There's always a lily in the valley, and I could preach all this good preachy preacher stuff. But that's what you see in Genesis chapter 6, verse 8. Read this with me. It's a very simple verse. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. You don't even have to get through the first six chapters of the Word of God before it's already pointing to salvation. God says, judgment is coming. I'm going to destroy everything. Death is coming on a global level. But I'm also a loving God. I'm also a merciful God. And so, Noah, I'm going to give you grace. And I'm going to extend grace to the entire world. And if Noah built one ark, I bet you he could have built four. Or 12. And the reason that there was only one was because only Noah and his family got on it. And here's what I want you to understand, is that God, just as we sang this morning, made a way for Noah. God made a way for all of humanity. He said, all you got to do is get on the ark. But here's the other account of the story and the flip side of the coin. There was only one way. And it was Noah's faith. Look at Hebrews chapter 11. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to what? Faith. What caused Noah to build an ark? Faith. How then, pray tell, did Noah and his entire household get saved? Faith. And this is the message of the gospel hidden, nestled right here in Genesis chapter 6. You say, people have been preaching this for a long time. Yes, you're right. Noah preached this message for 120 years. And you can believe it, not believe it. You can dismiss it. You can chalk me up as a religious nut job just like they chalked Noah up. But it does not change the truth that judgment is coming. And that Jesus is coming. And that the Bible calls Jesus the righteous judge. But here's the thing that I need you to understand. You are a sinner. You are guilty. But God made a way. There's only one way. Just like there was only one way in Genesis 6. The parallels are so crazy, they're hard to be ignored. And in John chapter 14, verse number 6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth. And the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. What is the Bible saying there? That there is one way. And just as Noah, this is what I want you to understand. Just as Noah found grace in the eyes of God, so have you this morning. You found yourself in a place, for whatever reason you came this morning, you hear the gospel message. Jesus Christ made a way for you. He gave his life for you. He rose again the third day for you. And now he's calling you. And you have a choice, a responsibility. You're accountable for the decision that you make. Will you accept this gift? This is the way that the book of Ephesians describes it. For by grace are you saved through faith, and the not of yourselves is a gift of God. And if you've never been saved this morning, what I need you to understand is that Jesus is the only way to heaven. Just like getting on that ark was the only way. And Jesus said, just as it was in the days of Noah, so also is the coming of the Son of Man. That is one of our signs. What I want you to understand, church, is that the more wicked the world gets, the more evil you see this world getting, the more evident, the more polarizing it should be that Jesus is coming back. Isaiah, I've heard that my whole life. Yeah, me too. But it's still true. How long did Noah give the 120 years? How long has God given? I don't know. This is our fifth installment, and I've told you every time, I do not know. But I want to ask you this morning, if he does, if it's today, are you ready? You serve a God that opens doors and closes doors. And one of the other things that's fascinating about this account is that God shuts the door and it doesn't open back up. If you don't believe me, read the Genesis account. Noah and his family leave through the roof. They remove the covering, the Bible says. But God isn't shutting doors here today. We're still living in the age of grace, theologically speaking, and it is one wide open door. And ironically enough, this is one of the names of our Lord. He says, I am the door. Walk through it. Come. Whatever your need is this morning, come. Let's pray together. Father God, thank you for this day. Thank you for your blessings, and Lord, I thank you so much for your grace. And Lord, it's abundantly clear that our world and our culture, everything, Lord, is getting more wicked. So, Lord, I pray that you would help us to stand. Pray that you would help us to be light in the darkness. Lord, I pray for the strength to be that city set on a hill. But, Lord, right now I ask that you would speak as only you can and do. Lord, if there's one here that's lost, I pray that you would give them the courage even now to come. Convict, speak. Lord, bless this, your church. Bless this time of invitation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Stand.
Isn't he wonderful? the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
All right, thank you for your attention this morning. Hey, be sure to check out our Mostly Peaceful protest next Sunday, same bat time, same bat channel, 10:30. Hey, tell somebody about Jesus this week. Invite somebody to come with you. Don't forget about our mission team. Please be praying for them throughout the coming. I think they're due. Travis told me I think they're due to get back on Friday-ish. So be praying for them. And it's been good to be in God's house. Amen. Aren't you glad to be saved? If you're here this morning and you're not, please see me back at the life table. Matt will be up here. If you want prayer, if you need anything, you're interested in joining the church, just come back, talk to me, get with Matt. We'll make that happen. But aren't you glad you serve a God that's your way maker? I love this song. This song will almost preach. One of these days, I'm gonna get up there and I'm going to be like, you know what, let's just scrap the sermon. Just let this song preach. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He made a way for Noah. He made a way for you. That's what he does. He makes a way, but he is the only way. Hey, let's sing it out. I love you, church.